Telemist, if you're talking, then I can't hear you right now. Sounds like you stuffed your microphone in a pile of socks or something.
I.
Hello.
Does it sound better now?
Yeah.
We should make some.
I know I'm supposed to like mention this towards the end, but I did notice a comment on one of the reuploads of my songs.
Oh, yeah.
I'm sure you've seen the reply.
Yes, of course I've seen it. Yeah. These kinds of interaction are so new to me that I don't even know how to react. Like, I guess if I get more famous or whatever, I'll get used to it. But it's so fucking crazy that the people actually like react like that to me, you know? I actually followed you because I reacted kind of the same way when I heard your shit.
Everyone knows me through that one song, and that's where I'm guessing you found me. SoundCloud
recommended.
Yeah. Same story with everybody.
The algorithm brings us together.
Yeah.
You should go for Matter Room next.
I should, yeah.
Good job.
Welcome everyone to this little podcast that still doesn't have a name. 3 episodes in and there's still nothing. It's just Glitchtrode's cast. I have no other original ideas. Before we start this podcast, then I'd like to thank everyone who's been listening so far and for giving feedback on to further improve the podcast. Episode 1, I've heard your feedback, and on episode 2, I've also heard your feedback. So thank you very much. So to get straight to the point, we have a special guest here today, someone that I didn't really expect to get in, to be quite honest. We have Telemist on the line.
Hello, it is me. How you doing?
I'm doing all right. Well, you know, to give a big bit of a backstory, it was meant to be recorded like a few days ago, but it got delayed.
Yeah, I had some like issues here personally, so I couldn't be on time, but it's better late than never.
So I'm still glad you're here regardless, and that you actually, well, you were a bit off schedule, but yeah.
Yeah, I'm always off schedule. It's something that I actually have to work on. But it happens with everything. It happens with like IRL stuff. I actually have to like put myself alarms to remind me that I gotta do some things. And I actually forgot to put the alarm for this, so I fucking forgot about it. My bad.
Even though I set calendars on what day, which day is which, I still like remember like every single day that it's on this date. So how's things on your end?
Things on my end are generally good. I'm actually gonna start a full-time job tomorrow, so that's really neat. And yeah. I'm gonna get some cool money to buy albums with, help my family with and stuff. So I'll probably slow down with the album that I'm working on, but I will have some stuff on the way because I send a lot of stuff to other people, so there's gonna be a lot of collabs on the way, getting ready to be delivered to everyone. You know, peanut butter jelly time in 2020, or Please Don't Stop the Music 2021, shit like that. I'm gonna work on some funny songs to just chill down, and I'm going to work on the album, and hopefully I'm just gonna have a good time with all of this.
Sounds fucking awesome. Oh, Jesus, I have a lot to go through this text file.
We can go with everything. I can't sleep for shit, so just let's do it.
All right, so we're going to start off. What is your opinion on your most popular songs? I'll bring up a few just to refresh your memory for a bit.
Yeah.
One, Dog Bus. Holy shit, that track.
Dog Bus is probably like the second or third coolest song I think that I've made, because like it's just a really good blend of what Meta Room can do and what I can do. There's like that distinct division from when the first drop ends to when I just start going out.
Yeah,
the project actually like went from a snippet for a video that a friend of Meta Room, Mafti, had done, and I saw it by some chance, and I just asked him, wait, can I actually work on this? It sounds really good, but I wanted to make a full song. So I made a full song out of it. First drop, I didn't know what to do, so I just asked Meta Room if he could do a first drop, and then the rest was just me doing whatever the hell I was doing at the moment. It came out really well. People like took it super well, probably because Meta Room has such a large following, and yeah. I was like kind of jumping onto it, but It was really cool. Matter Room's a really nice guy, and I definitely have some stuff working with him later.
Like, there's more?
There is at least one more. It's a three-way collab, so it's going to take a bit longer to come out, probably, but it's going to be really cool.
And Matter Room, what a guy. Yeah. I talked about him way too much on episode one, so I deeply apologize for that. I just think Matter Room's really cool. I didn't really get to talk to him that much. That's all I could say.
These days, he's kind of like offline, I think. He's just relaxing and taking some time for himself, which is completely fine, honestly. People just need time sometimes for themselves, and you gotta disconnect from the computer world.
Gotta disconnect from the Y2K land. So, about the remix compilation for Dogbus, was it like you and Menroom who chose out the remixes?
Yeah, we just put the announcement on Twitter like, oh yeah, we're giving away $60 for six remixes, and it was like, I actually got two friends of mine to make a remix, Quaston and Havoc. I didn't actually like prioritize them. Their remixes were so good that we just slapped one and two on them, and the rest were like from, I think it was 25 to 30 remixes. I can't really remember right now. We just chose the ones that we liked the most from there. It was actually a tough one because most of them were really good. And there was one in particular, Sujin's remix, that it was really good, but it had like some things that ticked me off a little bit too much. But we ended up choosing Sujin's remix. We made a group with them, with everyone, to just tell them, yeah, you guys won $10 each. And to discuss how payments were going to be and distribution, etc., etc., etc. And we kind of also gave them some more time to refine and get actual feedback to make it even better, you know? And there was a lot of remixes. I wish I could have fit at least half of them, but it was going to be a real tough job, honestly.
Oh man, yeah. Sujin was telling me like a few days ago, he even said it himself, that there's like a lot of imperfections in it, but either way, I commend him for even squeezing like an entire day in just to get that remix out.
One whole day.
I definitely know he's listening to this right now. He's probably gonna message you at some point about it.
I'm expecting the message to come in a couple minutes.
Depends on when is this episode's gonna come out. It's probably gonna be monthly, I guess, but so it's probably gonna come out on the 24th or 26th. Yeah, so you said there was about 25 to 30 that didn't make it.
Yeah.
So were there any other ones that you thought you liked?
Problem is, there were so many, I can't remember the names of the artists right now, but like, I could definitely take a look sometime later. I'm just going to search for everything that could be here. 22 remixes. I'm actually like searching our chat and going to, because we had a spreadsheet of the people that made the remixes. So I found it. There's a lot of cool names in here. There was I think it was Plus Plus Girls remix that I actually enjoyed a lot, and I couldn't get because, well, there were other choices that Matter Room and I were like more keen to get in. Ray the Nameless, Say No's remix were also very, very good. Komori Kurosawa, I think the name was, had a really, really cool take on it too. All of the remixes by these 22 people are super nice. If I could just put the 22 remixes in, I would just slap them in, you know?
Just a mega comp, yeah, that would be awesome. Like, if there's B-sides, then yeah, go for it.
I could talk to Matter Room about it, definitely. We could try to arrange something. But I also have kind of like the fear that if we feel like we're pumping too much out of Dogbus, we already did the remixes, we already did the actual song, and I'm not sure, you know, if the next thing that maybe could be in a normal progression would be a music video, but like, that's a lot of work, and Matter Room is probably working on other projects, and I am working on other projects, so I don't want to feel like I'm milking Dogbus.
Yeah, that's fair, especially how it recently just got 100k views on YouTube. Congratulations, by the way.
When I saw it, I was like, kind of like jumping in place in my mind, because like, 100K views just for a song that I have done, you know, partially, but I have done it.
It's not like, it's not the first time though.
Yeah, envy.
Yeah. Yes. Yes.
And that's where you transition to ask me about it, right?
Well, yeah, kinda. Yeah, fuck. I lost my train of thought. Yeah. I'll just move on to envy. What's your opinion on envy?
Envy is actually one of my personally the most hated tracks.
I should have expected that, because with a song with that high of a number, like, it's, at some point artists are just gonna get sick of just being known as that guy who made such and such song.
Yes and no. See, the thing is, it's not like I'm angry at Envy being popular or anything, and I'm definitely not angry at people for liking Envy instead of other songs. It's just like, when I made it, which was like, I think it was my fourth song uploaded, there was Accident, Waves, Rush, and then that. But that one was like a 30-minute mishmash of just, okay, let's get some choir sounds and stab sounds from default FL Studio and just put them through a distortion plugin and just make a stupid melody with them, then slap and aim and break and compress, distort it a little bit, and then add a sub bass, and then yeah, that's it. You know, I'm not entirely, it's not that I don't like the song, is it? It's so simple to me that I can't actually believe that such a simple song would get so much, you know, would be like so talked about and played and have so many plays and comments, although most of them come from the fact that, you know, Franz J, I think the name was, played it on one of his streams while he was playing CSGO, and then there was a boom. There was a day where I had like 12K plays or so, 10K, just because Franz J had played two of my songs, Envy and the Finite remix, and I was like super, super, super in disbelief.
And that's where the comments Franz J presents show up on SoundCloud. I even got some of those comments, yeah. I've noticed. Especially with yours.
Yeah, Franz J. I actually didn't know who it was until Ev, which is one of my best musical friends, just told me, yo, have you ever played CSGO? And I was like, no. And he told me about, you know, there's this guy called Franz J, which he's very, very famous, and he plays CSGO. And I was like, are you trying to get me into him or into CSGO? And he was like, no, he played your song on stream and you're getting like 1,000 fucking views. And I was like, what? Like, I was completely oblivious to Franz's existence until that. And honestly, I still don't like CSGO after watching it. Too much effort just to shoot someone. I want to play Gears of War when I can just pull the trigger and it's easier.
Oh yeah, okay, yeah, I remember what I was gonna say earlier, because I it was going back to that thing where Dogbus reached 100k views. I remember you had tweeted up about it. You were just like, what, when was this? And then I was just, I replied to it saying now. Now, period.
I actually laughed my ass off when I read it.
Really?
Like, yeah, it was like pulling down a notification on the phone is like, and
now
I opened it. And I'm in the twin lines, wait, when? And they just say, no. That was left my ass.
Oh, God. Okay. Let's move on to another song you might be very familiar with. Only one word I'll ever say. Glidelas or glideless.
Oh, yeah.
You know what I'm talking about.
There's two that I can think of. There's Synapse and there's PK Rave.
PK Rave. That's what I was going for. I was just playing earlier today
when PK I was up to the store. So fun to make.
Yeah, I know, but unfortunately you cannot distribute any of your tracks to like Spotify or whatever. How many people have asked you that, really?
I've been asked about it a couple times, honestly. It's just that I don't want to use any platform that I can directly use. I like Bandcamp because I can upload myself, same with SoundCloud, same with YouTube, but Spotify, you gotta go through a lot of hoops to just get a song in there. Or I think Apple Music has the same issue, but I wouldn't exactly be talking with any knowledge, honestly, because I haven't used Apple Music. But Spotify is kind of like too many hoops to get your songs in there and they don't pay shit, so I might as well, you know, not support a company that doesn't like the artists that are in it. There was like an interview where one of the members, I can't actually remember now, said something along the lines of, oh, this platform is not oriented towards paying artists, it's just oriented to not allow piracy. And I was like, if you don't pay people, just go to piracy anyway. I'm not gonna support Spotify, so I'm not probably, at least not my solo songs, I'm not gonna get them in there.
So PK Rave, what'd you think of it?
Most of it was Glidelas work. I only made the drops and some of the parts between them, put some effects in the vocals, but the stabs were made by him, the initial breaks were made by him. Most of the stems of the song were actually made by him. That's why his name is first, because he made most of the work.
Where do you fit in there?
I made the drop and basically put it all together, like re-glued it with some of my stuff. Glidelas' solo projects are good, but they kind of lack strength sometimes and some characters. So I just, you know, slapped some dance drums on it. What could go wrong? And it worked. It worked really well. And so I decided to just make the whole song like that. And it worked really well. I honestly can't say much about it because I don't feel like I've really done much to it. I just kind of, not really fixed it, but added my touch and helped Glidelas kind of mix it a bit and master it afterwards. So I think the props are more for him than for me.
I know Glidelas is gonna listen to this at some stage. I've gotten in contact with them recently. I send them stems to a really old song, not really old, but an old song I made like last year that they really liked, and I'm still waiting for something from them. Glidelas, if you're listening, you gotta get back to me, bro. It's been like, it's been almost a month. Or maybe it's been a month or two, really.
It's not as bad as what I've done, though. There was a, don't exactly know this person's pronouns, but there was this person on Twitter named Jans Pollet that also makes breakcore and atmospheric drum and bass and kind of those kinds of music. A long time ago, maybe kind of like a year ago, I liked one of their tracks and I actually asked them to make something. I don't think they saw, but some days later on Twitter, they actually asked me to make something with them. So I was like, okay, send stems and we'll see how it works out. And they sent stems and I had a problem with my computer. I lost the stems and I forgot to ask them again. And then when I remembered about asking them, I was like, shit, if I ask now, I'm gonna look like an idiot. And so I kind of forgot about it till now. Jans, if you're listening, I'm so very sorry. I do still want to work, but like, now that I have a good computer, we could actually do something. Here's the thing. When I was in the stems, I put them all together in FL Studio and it was super good. And I was like, I don't think I can fix this. I don't think I can do anything to it. You know, what the hell do I do with this? I don't want to fuck it up. Same when Ruru Yose sent me stems to make something together. And I was like, the fuck do I do with this? This is really good. I don't know what I should do. And it happens a lot with me because like people just come to me and ask me, oh, want to make something? I was like, okay, send something. And when they send it, it's great. Okay, this is great. What the hell am I doing here? Like, I get the intention of like getting me in there, but there's some songs that are just so fucking good. Those songs are too good for me to just burst their bubble, you know?
You know, sometimes I remix without stems at all. I just take the action, like, okay, I'll just use my Metaroom Angel remix as an example. With that remix, all I really just did is chop up little bits of the song and then try, like, form at least something and then change the pitch just a tiny bit. And then I just do the rest. That's basically the entire process. Like, that took me about 12 hours in total just to make in the span of a month because I had to like move away from it. So no, I rarely use stems, and I do, and I'd feel so dumb just to ask somebody for them, because either A, they don't have them, or B, they do, but I'm just too shy to ask.
It's happened to me too. Yeah, I understand where you come from.
What other popular songs do you have? Because the only ones that I did think of was Dogbuzz, Envy, and PK Rave. I was thinking Arachna, but...
Is Arachna actually popular? I don't think it's that popular.
Oh, that's the purpose of the internet. Let's search this up.
I would say that my most popular songs would be Envy, the Finite Remix, Peanut Butter Jelly Time. I'd even argue that, I don't know, the... Boston Right Back Home Remix and Radiation, some of those like kind of scattered songs. Thank You is a song that I've also received a lot of love for, so I don't know if that means it's popular or if it's good.
Well, it was in Favicon volume, I forgot which one was it, because yeah, I recognized the cover art from anywhere. Yeah,
it was the first volume, and I was like the last song, and it was the closing song.
Oh,
it felt so cool, you know. Back then, when I started making Telemist, I kind of side project. I had like another alias that I abandoned completely now, and Telemist was just kind of like, okay, I saw this cool artist on the internet called Sewerslvt. Let's make music like this person.
I feel like this is just going to be a trend on the podcast where we're just going to constantly mention her with each episode. I'm going to get complaints about that eventually.
It's not your fault that most of us have kind of like stepped in that territory at least once.
I just gotta ask if you've ever interacted with her.
Yes. Ooh. Yes, I have.
Tell me about it.
Have you ever tried to talk like at a brick wall? Well, the brick wall usually exists. Sometimes like I feel like that Sewerslvt didn't exist. It was like, oh yeah, this is a Discord account. Sometimes a message pops up, but that was it. Like, I don't think that she was too fond of talking to people. And the only real interactions were, like, me asking her after... Because, like, we were on the same compilation. Both of us appeared together at the Favicon Volume 1 thing. And after that happened, I was, like, having some kind of conversation with her. Because back then, the unofficial Sewerslvt Discord, the Sewercord, now Axela, kind of... rebranded after all these things that surfaced around her and people not being comfortable around her image or her music anymore. There was a point where she was in the server, and we ended up actually like having different conversations about, is the Ozone plugins any good? How does fame change you, if you can even call whatever you have fame? Because like, she makes a lot of money out of her music, so does that eventually change you? Like, the way people see you, have you gotten used to it, or is it still a new experience to you, and stuff like that. Then the conversation kind of like died out, and then I asked her again if she had stems to any song, because I was in a creative blog, and I was like, okay, when I'm in a creative blog, I ask people to do the work for me, so I'm just gonna ask for stems. And she kind of just let me all read, and we haven't talked ever since.
I did drop a few mentions about me having a very unfortunate conversation with her, but again, I'll try not to reveal anything, because it's...
You gotta tell me that after this.
Yeah, I have to. Well, if you still want to stay in the fucking VC after I'm done recording, then I can tell you.
No problem.
All right.
I am a juicy person. I love those juicy things, but I can't bring myself to actually ask about it.
Yeah, I just usually keep that shit to myself, because, again, there's been a lot of controversies, and I just don't want to throw any more fuel to the fire, so.
Although I think it's burning high enough after the N-word incident, Kiwi Farms thread, which is funny because it also got me in there. Like, people started mentioning me in that thread, and I was like, okay, shit. They also mentioned N-Fract and started mentioning other artists there. Even she got shit just because she was kind of like seen as the cleaner version of Sewerslvt in a sense. Because, well, N-Fract hasn't done shit.
Yeah.
But it's the same aesthetic. So it was kind of like natural that they ended up going, oh, look, another Sewerslvt.
Even then, I'm still kind of like skeptical to talk to Enfract. Like, it's nothing against them. I just feel a bit iffy. That's all.
Oh no, she's nice. I can guarantee she's a good person. She's nice. She might appear like a bit distant sometimes, but it's normal. It's how she is.
Mm. Is there anything more you want to add on to the Sewerslvt conversation? Because once again, it's probably going to be like a reoccurring thing in the upcoming episodes.
So. Only if you bring it up.
Yeah, but this time you brought it up.
Oh yeah, because back then she was like my go-to artist. She was like my favorite thing in the world.
Dude, same. I cannot hide it. I'm the same way. Well, kind of.
Then like before discovering all the shit that she had on, but like back then I was sharing a compilation with her. It was like a dream come true. What comes after that, a collab or whatever? And I was like, I was already imagining a million futures, you know.
Dude, and then nothing happened. She's a very distant person.
Yeah, which, you know, it bugged me in the moment, but like I can totally understand now.
Yeah,
that I'm kind of a look back.
Siberia Layer 3 actually fucks, though. I really like that one.
Yeah. It's really good.
Dude, that was like one of the first songs I listened to when I was like in that car near the end of June 2020. I was like, I was on my seat clenching. This is too fucking good. And that's where I started popping up. Because yeah. I just made a song that sounded similar to hers and then everything just changed. You know, before that, I was doing YouTube videos, right? Like, I was making gaming YouTube videos where I just record myself playing video games, edited, uploaded. I had, like, multiple face cam videos. I even had a green screen set where I brought my camera up and then put myself behind a green screen and I'd use that as the face cam. Those were good days, but honestly, moving to the music community feels a whole lot better.
I do gotta say, you have a YouTuber voice. I don't know how to explain it.
Well, because I've been doing YouTube since 2016 for that long, I've just kind of grown to be very comfortable with talking to the microphone and being in front of the camera. But since I don't think anybody knows what I look like, maybe I'll do a face reveal, maybe not. I kind of want to stay anonymous for the time being.
That's absolutely respectable. I yeah. wanted to like hide my face too, but not enough. It's not because I don't like my face, which is, you know, the face I was born with. The fuck am I gonna do to it? I'm a good fan of privacy on the internet, you know?
Yeah.
If the moment does reach where it's necessary to, like, show my face or whatever, well, yeah, I will. But, like, if I don't have to and I don't feel like doing it, why would I?
Mm-hmm.
I feel like there's a lot of people that just have this tendency to kind of overexpose things to the internet. But, like, since it's not really my business, I don't really say anything about it. It would bother me if I did it, you know?
Yeah. So that's my backstory for you. Yeah. Moving on to music was definitely a very good decision to do because if I'm being honest, then I feel like nobody would be really impressed if you just straight up told them, hey, I'm a YouTuber nowadays. Picture it like this. You do music, you tell somebody, oh, I do music. Then they actually start taking you seriously. But if you tell them, hey, I make YouTube videos, then they'll just look at you funny. That's what I think of it as.
Really? Like, yeah. I've heard people and I've seen people, friends of mine mostly, just go, oh, yeah, I make music, whatever. And people don't take it seriously because maybe it's where I live, right? People just see music as a kind of like art that doesn't take you anywhere. It's like, oh, yeah, it's music, but so what? You know, does it pay well? I feel like people are just too focused on the economic aspect.
Yeah.
Like, I'm definitely sure that I'm not going to do a living out of this. So it's not like I'm going to focus on making money out of it. And the money I make is going for my parents to pay bills and buy food and stuff. You know, if I can help around the house, I'm going to do it. And if I get like 40, 50, whatever amount of money every month that I can just alleviate from them, is going to be great. I'm going to get a job eventually and I'm going to slow this down and I don't think it's going to die, but like it's definitely something that I'm not going to like try to exploit or take seriously, because once you start taking these things seriously, they start to stress you. You start to worry too much about it. And if you worry too much about it, you're going to suffer much more from it, you know?
Yeah, eventually you're going to start getting really busy and not reply that much. Buckcore even said it himself.
Honestly, I think Metarum can actually kind of make a big chunk or a decent chunk. I don't actually know the exact quantity of the chunk of money that he can make, but if he I know he does take commissions. I know he also has nice sales and band camp, so yeah. I have to ask him, but I'm willing to bet 1 cent or two that he can actually make a good amount of money from music, which result in probably kind of taking it like a job, because if you make a lot of money from something, means you're taking it seriously. And if you're taking it seriously, you're working a lot to stay afloat with it.
You which know, would, I can never do that.
I think I can do that, but I choose not to, because like in the end, I don't exactly know how far music will take me. If I start putting expectatives on myself, if I start imagining things that maybe won't happen, then yeah, what I was saying earlier, I'm just going to get sad that I didn't like go super viral or whatever, or that I didn't meet the quota or whatever. You know, I'm going to worry too much about something that I care, love, and want to, you know, do and not, like, have to do.
Yeah, getting popular is obviously, like, a big thing. If I'm being honest, then I'd rather just stay underground. I don't ever want to go mainstream. Being underground can have a lot of benefits, and it can open you up to a lot of artists that you and I probably have never heard of. And chances are they could be like hidden gems or something.
That's what bothers me. People just go, oh, music isn't good anymore. These artists aren't good anymore. But I don't see anyone digging up for themselves.
Yeah.
Which I kind of blame myself for it too, because my finds are basically because SoundCloud recommends me. Take note, future telemist. Do some research for yourself. Don't let the algorithms dictate your taste.
Yeah, a lot of people are just like ignorant about like discovering new music, because with platforms such as SoundCloud, people just more or less assume that it's just a place overridden by SoundCloud rappers. But you can definitely find something else other than SoundCloud rapping.
Thing about SoundCloud though is that I feel like there's a lot more producers than listeners on SoundCloud.
Yeah.
Because like I've kind of like made a little experiment in a sense where I just checked people's socials and then saw if their YouTube channel had more subscribers than followers had at SoundCloud. And most of the time they had like more YouTube followers than SoundCloud. But in the case that it happened otherwise, I just checked who was following them on SoundCloud. And most people were producers. Or bots. It was a bit weird. I feel like SoundCloud is more tailored towards people who make music, especially when it comes to recommendations. Have you ever like heard anything like neurofunk or any kind of complex genre like that that requires a lot of knowledge and sound design?
Yeah, I've heard a lot of subgenres like these.
Well, people that make those are actually guided by the algorithm to find people who make things like that. It kind of becomes a bit of an echo chamber in a sense for producers. I don't feel like it really attracts listeners the way places like YouTube or even Spotify or even Apple Music do. Since people can just upload it themselves instead of going through a million hoops, it just looks like it's worse for some people, and then they don't use it as a listening tool.
I was going to mention how hyperpop used to be like this complex genre thing, micro genre, whatever, subgenre, whatever you like to call it, and now it's just kind of becoming more mainstream now. So maybe at some point neurofunk could be like a big thing in the future, but who knows.
I wish. I love that kind of music. There was a time where vaporwave was almost mainstream, both the music and the aesthetic. Same with future funk. Help, people like Young Bay or Macros 8299 still make bangers to this day.
It's crazy how vaporwave just evolved as a genre over the years. It used to be just Macintosh Plus, the Echo Gems, and now it's just become more ambient things using samples from other songs.
It's a really complex genre now, because people just used to call vaporwave anything that had like Windows 95 aesthetic.
Or 80s music.
Yeah. And just slowed down and reverbed. I don't want to say it's a dead genre, because I'm sure it's not. It's definitely lost the popularity that it had. Same with future funk. For example, vaporwave art is just now a meme graveyard. There's no actual vaporwave art. It's just, oh yeah, this thing has blue, it has purple, and it has pink. Oh, this must be Vaporwave now.
Oh, this must be Blank Banshee then.
Did you learn how to fly head? Where did you learn to fly?
Yeah.
That is Vaporwave too. That is Blank Banshee album zero, whatever, you know?
My favorite song is Teen Pregnancy. Imagine people saying that shit to someone. Oh, have you heard of Blank Banshee? My favorite song is Teen Pregnancy. And they're just like, what the fuck? What are you talking about?
Imagine just going up to a random stranger and going like, oh yeah, have you listened to Sewerslvt? My favorite song is Was It Weird when I was listening to Clams Casino, whatever, when I lost
Oh, God. Have you listened to Sewerslvt? Have you listened to their albums, Starving Sluts Always Get Their Fix?
That's the point where we start talking about her again, right?
Well, kind of. Because I was going to say, a lot of people say, oh, I don't like her genre. It's so dark and edgy. But then, like, I can argue that there are so many other bands like that who just do almost the exact same thing, and then nobody just gives a shit. Even, like, death metal artists. They
yes.
Do that.
I guess it's also a kind of different culture. It's also a different situation, too. In the case of, like, most death metal artists, I am completely uneducated on what I'm going to say. It is my opinion, so I will research out after we record this. It's not the same to just talk about a glorified version of, like, death, hell, and, I don't know, fire, skulls, Satan, whatever, or, I don't know, touching any touchy subjects for the hell of it, in a sense, than just speaking of different kind of quote-unquote evils like depression or fear of death or stuff like that, you know? It does have kind of like the same appearance in a sense, but it's not really coming from the same place.
Yeah.
So I can definitely see why people don't give a shit about death metal, because, I mean, it's death metal. The fuck are they going to talk about? Jesus? Well, there's probably someone that did already, but, you know, it's definitely different. What genre is Sewerslvt anyway? Just ambient D&B.
Ambient D&B, yeah. Stuff like that.
Ambient D&B is nice. What people don't like is that she has this capacity to just put her problems and songs on the world, you know?
Yeah.
And I don't know, people may not just be fans of that because it's, I don't know, uncomfortable to them in a way that, I don't know, talking about Satan, it's not the same saying like, oh, death, evil, cold, Satan, Beelzebub, then saying, oh yeah, I have been depressed for like 9 fucking years and I want to throw myself off a cliff, you know?
So I feel like that topic would be like too touchy, so just to be mindful, I'm probably not going to get too in-depth about the inner working of Sewerslvt and what she was actually thinking during that time, so. Yeah, because, yeah.
Fair, but yeah, that's, I guess, my quote-unquote explanation to why it can happen. Yet
I haven't bumped Sewer in such a long time. I just sort of stopped, especially after the controversies and stuff. Last time I listened was when what was that album called, her latest one,
Schizophrenia Simulation, I think.
Yes, that one. That was the last time I ever listened to her. I thought it was all right, but it's the same formula, whatever. Like, at some point it's gonna get stale. But I've taken a look at the mastering, and Jesus Christ.
It's not good.
Yeah, I put one of her songs on Audacity, and literally saw that it looked like a block of noise.
Here's the thing, it's not that it's badly mastered, it's like, it's badly mixed. Whatever you master, it's already gonna sound, like, weird, at least. Yeah. The songs definitely have potential. I think there was a house song in that album that just sounds like if I was 13 and a half, grabbed Apple Studio for the first time. And no offense, but it's just, I don't know. The kick drum, it's just boom, boom, boom. And you can feel the frequencies, you know, and it just bothers me so much. I guess if you're going for a more like, I'm going to express whatever the fuck I'm feeling and not worry that much about it sounding good, then yeah, I can understand the approach. Doesn't mean I'm gonna like it, but people like it anyway because, I don't know, they swallow her songs like if they were water and they needed it or whatever.
Yeah, and no offense to the fan base either way. The fan base helped me out tremendously.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Sewerslvt fans are fucking amazing.
Yeah, I know.
But it's not amazing anymore, sadly.
I did make a remix of one of her songs back in November. Posted on the subreddit, and I've totally grown since then after that. Like, I don't know what I expected was going to happen, but just that was, wow. Because I've gotten so many new people listening to me after that, and it was great. It was great.
Yeah, it happened to me too, because I know it was last year. I can't actually remember the month, but but I did remix Mr. Kill Myself long ago. And back then I was like, I don't know, getting a monthly 100 listeners. It was shit quantities, which is not bad. But back then I was not famous. I didn't have any following. I was just uploading songs. And it somehow reached 2K in a week. And I was like, what the fuck? Turns out she had reposted it. I don't know the correct terms for this, but like, she reposted it on her SoundCloud and a lot of people came from there, and I actually probably got a 50 follower boost from that. People that actually like Sewerslvt and I, some of them became good friends. I don't know if you know Shay.
Yeah, I know. I was talking to Shay a few weeks ago in the Nothing World Discord VC. All right, so to move on from the Sewerslvt talk, I feel like that went on for way too long than I thought. Okay, so to move on, do you have any stories to share? Any funny, awkward, whatever?
I don't think I actually have like a lot of stories to share, but there's one character that keeps appearing on my Twitter and I can't just stop laughing about it. Their name is Big Stalling. The way they talk just makes me laugh a lot every time it happens. Honestly, the only stories that you could take out of me would be if I remember them, because you asked me about a specific situation. But otherwise, I don't think I've actually had like any bad blood between someone and me, or any really good thing happened that I can tell yet. It would be weird. I wouldn't know what to say. If you ask me, I'll probably just start rambling again.
How did you get your name? Just get straight to the point. How did you get your name?
This is going to be super awkward. Before making music, I used to write fan fiction under this name. Oh. Sadly, I deleted all my work, so you'll never, ever get to read.
What do you mean, sadly? That's like, that's good.
Yeah, but I made some really questionable smut to say it somehow, and I definitely don't want my name associated with that. I ended up just like deleting all my literary works and just starting from scratch something else. But yeah, before I made music, I was just, you know, writing naughty stuff and archive of our own. And now I make music. Yeah, probably not the background story you expected, huh?
Definitely not. It's probably might have been like a combination of words or whatever.
No, I don't usually think those things too much through.
Yeah, me neither.
Sounds good.
So what were you actually thinking when you made that PB&J remix? What was the outlandish backstory, as I've written here?
It is not an outlandish backstory. I met some people at Matterroom server. They were super nice. They were like asking me to like, can we draw your character? And stuff. And I was like, oh, fuck yeah. But if you're going to draw it, I'm just going to commission you. Then I remember that I don't have a bank account that I can pass my money onto PayPal for. So I just like, okay, I'm going to exchange you a song for some art. And they chose a song. They wanted me to remix Peanut Butter Jelly Time. But the thing is, since it was a kind of like a meme song, I went to YouTube and just searched meme sound pack. And I found one and I just, you know, I made the intro and started chucking memes at it. And then I just, wait, this actually can do something. That's how kind of the remix came out to be. It's not like it has a super crazy backstory, but it was stupid enough. And they loved it. They loved it so much. I'm actually super proud that I did it. Not because it's a good song, but because making that song kind of changed the way that I made music and the way that I saw making music. Because before, I just used to try to express myself. And back then, where I wasn't really feeling well, you know, if you listen to my early work, Accident, Waves, Envy, Rush, any of those, they're not really like super bouncy or happy or whatever, because I wasn't like feeling like that. Making something like that actually got me feeling like that a bit more. Instead of making music that reflected how I felt, I started making music that reflected how I wanted to feel. And that's how those bouncy, cool songs like that one, PK Ray, We Still Like to Party, and
yeah.
All of those kind of things.
The Nothing World Discord is actually pretty nice. There's a few people on there that I really enjoy talking to, for real.
There's a lot of cool people, dude.
Yeah, I know. If any of them are listening, hello. How you doing? Okay, I still got more to go.
Oh yeah, bring it on, bring it on.
All right, what were your inspirations for your music other than Sewer? Because I know you said that.
My early works, well, we know who we're talking about.
Yeah.
And there's not really a lot of kind of like inspiration, I'd say, for many more artists. I think I was, from whatever the hell I listen to, I just get something. You know, I like to listen to a lot of dubstep. So when I started making my own dubstep songs, I started kind of referencing my favorite dubstep artists. I would see Sizzy, Akios, many more, Ominous. And I ended up eventually meeting some of them, which is super nice. Flood, even Arcade Blaster, maybe. But there's, I guess, clear references. I say Sewerslvt, Akios, Virtual Riot, Voland.
Yeah, I'm the same as you. I don't really have a lot of inspiration for any songs. It's just whatever I do is just me.
In the end, like, the more things you listen to, it doesn't really actually matter that much unless you do like the artist a lot, which will happen with Sewerslvt, Voland, and yeah, the other people I've mentioned. Other than that, it's just I've listened to so many cool songs, you know, and I've listened to so many cool artists. A lot of people that have just been part of my life now are kind of influences to me because I just love what they do. And I think you can do something like them, too. And I start taking everyone as a kind of inspiration.
Alrighty, let's move on next. Is there anything you're working on right now?
I'm making an album. It's going to be a long one. And it's probably going to take a long bit of time. But I expect to, by the end of the year, have at least half of it done. I am working on filler songs to, well, fill the time while I work on the album. I do have a couple collaborations on the way because just to prepare for making some time before the album comes out. And while I make it, I don't have to, like, work so much to put stuff out. Meanwhile, I'm also working on a music video for Peanut Butter Jelly Time.
Great. With,
other than Sirenek, which is
Yeah, I know him. Yeah, that's cool.
Which is super fucking cool, honestly. But I can't say I have like a busy schedule or that I'm doing a lot of things because honestly, I just take music and I don't like putting pressure on myself or doing more than I should do. So I just take it calmly and do whatever at my rhythm. I wish I had like news or anything, but I don't want to become someone that just, I'm going to announce that I'm doing X things and then, oh shit, I have to do X things, right? I'm just gonna go like, yeah, whatever comes.
For me, whenever I announce a project or something, then I usually announce it when I'm actually finished with it and then plan the release date a week or two beforehand. If I end up making a project or something and it doesn't go well, I just don't want to be like, oh, sorry guys, this project is canceled because I'm feeling very demotivated and I can't think of anything right now. That's happened before. Yeah, I just rather release it whenever I want to, and when it comes, it comes. That sounds out of context.
If CD Projekt Red could delay Cyberpunk 2077 for like 1,000 years and have it come out as a shitty game, anyone can just put anything out and be like, oh yeah, I'm not gonna do this, I'm sorry, you know? It's better to just focus on one's mental health and one's like own taste sometimes, just putting shit out. I want to work with an artist, Logan, LLWLL. I think that's kind of like their name. They've only been producing for 2 months, but I'm in love with what they do. The concepts of what they do are really great, and I love them, and they're so good. The execution, not that much, but, you know, what the hell are you going to tell to someone who's been making music for 2 months, right?
Yeah.
You can't just expect them to have the best of the best knowledge. They had an album put out, and they were telling me that they wanted to delete it. And I was like, why? And I was like, because it's shit. I made it a long time ago. It doesn't sound good. In the heat of the moment, I just don't. It's not bad. You're just really, like, young when it comes to lifespan of producer. You know, you've been just been 2 months making stuff. You shouldn't be comparing yourself to other people yet when you don't even know what you're doing most of the time. So just take it easy, relax, do your best, learn, take everything with a grain of salt, but like, don't take it too seriously because
If you stress out now and you're burning yourself out now, you're not going to like it afterwards. Deleting maybe isn't like the best move in my opinion, but I can definitely understand someone who would want to do that.
I was actually thinking of canceling my Metaroom Remix EP because I have no ideas. That's the thing. I announced it on my first episode with Buckcore, and I just, like halfway through working on that Sticker Invasion remix, I was just like, fuck, man, I really can't think of anything. I have to, like, I was thinking of doing all these tracks, and I really can't think of anything. Either way, if I made them in my own time, then surely I'll release them individually. Freddie will like it either way, so. It's not like it matters anyways. So, maybe it'll happen, but I really cannot be certain when a concrete release date is.
Did you ever, like, say, like, you didn't say a concrete release date. So you can just take as much time as you want. That's a mind hack there. But, like, when you envision big projects like that, you usually tend to envision the finished product without actually having made the product. It's a weird thing that happens. When I started thinking about the album, I was like, oh, it's going to have 14 songs, and really cool art, and it's going to be really cool. And then I started making the first song, and I was like, fuck.
Exactly how I felt.
Because when you start narrowing down things, going bit by bit, like, what do I want to transmit with the album, or if I even want to transmit anything, so it doesn't look like I just put 14 tracks together on a folder and called it a day. Do I want to have a common theme? Do I have any recognizable elements? Does it even have a lore of any kind? How much work am I willing to put on this album so that I can fit my own vision in it? Am I going to be proud of it? And so you start asking yourself all these questions, and then the dream of making the album kind of is not a dream anymore.
It's now something that you, like, start to feel like you have to do. But, you know, the key, I guess, is to take it slowly, do everything kind of individually, and stuff ends up coming out really consistently anyways.
What I did was just make a spreadsheet of what I wanted to do and how to do it. It's coming along nicely, actually. I have 3 songs of the, I don't know, whatever songs I have, 10-something, 14, 17, 16, hell, maybe I have 20. I doubt I have 20, but... 20.
Yeah, 20's a tad bit too much.
If I ever made, like, 2 sides, then, yeah. I remember, like, listening when I was younger to a David Guetta album. It was, I think it was Nothing But The Beat, and it had, like, 2 sides. First side was all the David Guetta songs that I have already heard on the radio, and the second side were actually original instrumental David Guetta tracks that I did not know existed, and they were so cool, so much more cooler than the ones that I already listened to. So maybe I can do that. I'll maybe do it when I already have a lot of tracks that I can put on an A side and then just make the tracks for the B side.
Yeah, I'm really looking forward to the album, that's for sure. Didn't you say that you made Fast Forward in like a day or something, or what?
Yeah.
How?
I just woke up like super early. Like I had scheduled to kind of like make it, so I was like, this Saturday I'm just not gonna go anywhere, I'm not gonna do anything. I woke up at 6 a.m I sat on the computer and I was like, all right, fuck it, let's do it. And I just did it. Why? Because I could. Lo-fi hip-hop is kind of like a soul formula, so I thought, yeah, what if I made a lo-fi album in a day? And Fast Forward is what actually came out of the whole thing. I was going to make more songs, but then I realized that, maybe I should just take a rest instead of, like, continuing to push things.
Yeah.
I named the songs the next day and kind of organized it. But the music was made in a whole day.
Christ. I didn't directly mention Fast Forward, but I remember seeing the Bandcamp description, and I immediately went on Twitter, like, is it really possible to just make an album in a day? And the majority said no. So, I guess anything's possible now.
In my defense, some of the songs have loops instead of, like, me making the actual sounds, the effects, or whatever. So, it's definitely easier to work with things that are already pre-constructed.
Yeah.
Which helps if you want to make an album in a day.
Is there any other artists you want to collab with in the future?
This is a loaded question because, of course, there are. There's a lot of artists that I want to make stuff with. But at the same time, if they're making something else or they're focused on something else, I feel like if people are going to bug them about making stuff with me that I don't want to say, but for example, Akios is someone that I definitely want to make something with other than what we already have done, which hopefully it'll come out soon. I can't really talk about it. Sanjo, I also want to make something with him. Enfract, we have something already going on.
Ooh.
And I have a collab with Alaska Bell on the way. I want to make something with Quaston, Flood Dubs, maybe even Havoc. I love Havoc style, but I'm just like what happened with Jans. I'm just afraid that I'm going to just fuck it up. But there's definitely a lot of artists that I would like to make stuff with. Invective, have J Pebro, Volgen. I love Volgen. And Volan. I would love to do something with Volan. But there's like so many things that I want to do, but at the same time, so many things that I also want to work on, and so many things that I'm also working on. But if I ever make a list of people that I want to collab, I don't want to feel like it's going to become a task to do it, you know?
Yeah.
So there's, of course, a lot of people that I want to make things with, but I'm just going to take it slowly, as I always do. And just when the time comes, I'll definitely do something with everyone, because I love to do music with people. Just send me whatever, or I send whatever. It's kind of like a conversation in a sense, because you can feel the parts that are that have been done with by each person. So it's really cool when two people just get together and make music.
And I think that's, oh my god, we've gone through the entire file. I have everything written down in this notepad. check, whatever, we have everything. Okay, so let's turn the tables a little bit. Is there anything you want to ask me? You're honestly, the interviewer this time.
Oh. There's honestly like not a lot of things that I want to ask you, but one of them is definitely, what's your old YouTube channel? I want to watch the shit out of your videos now.
Well, they're all private now, and it's on a now defunct channel, which has a blank profile picture, a blank banner, a blank name, literally a blank character as the name, and hidden subscriber count. So literally everything is blanked out.
Well, at least tell me your favorite video that you had to take down because of transitioning to music.
I privated everything. It's not taken down. I could still go through it, but it was definitely like one of those videos where I've written down on a script and then read it out, kind of like a review documentary type form. I do remember making some sort of analysis on a horror game called Sad Satan. I remember people really liking that. And there was another one where I reviewed an anime called Beastars. And and I think those types of videos were my favorites because they actually took real effort and they took me weeks to make it, to put together. That's probably all you're going to hear from my past, and as for the rest of the videos, they're just like gaming videos, let's plays, whatever. And that's it.
Did you enjoy your time as a YouTuber?
I did gain quite a bit of a following. I did rack up about 500 subscribers, but I don't like all of them watched, so just the transition to music. There was no looking back when I made that transition, because I knew that making music was definitely a thing that I wanted to do, and I still want to do to this day.
Music is one of the best things that has happened to humans, honestly. I believe it is. I see it as like writing but in different language, and there's writers with a couple words they can just make you melt. There's a lot of people that I love their music, and now that I actually kind of know how to make some stuff and how to make some other stuff, I now see the difficulty that they have to like make such amazing tunes, and it just pumps me up more. I wanted to do that. I wanted to inspire people to make stuff, and in secret I do want to go a bit big, and if I ever could live off of music, it would be great. But if I'm being more realistic, I'll probably just settle down with a nice job and, I don't know, live a comfortable life of my
own. Just treat it as a bit of a hobby, right?
Yeah. If I ever get stressed of it, it's just gonna feel like shit.
Yeah.
I know that. Before I started Telemist, I had another alias. Wasn't really big. But I was basically focused on getting big. I was following trends. I was doing whatever. And I felt like I had to be on the wave all the time, or it was going to drown me. Then I just stopped making music under that name. And I was just like, okay, I'm just going to let metaphorical wave drown me down. And I just, you know, turns out I knew how to dive, you know?
Yeah.
If you just take it easy, if you stop worrying about results and start worrying about the process, you're just going to have so much better of a time with everything. Art, music, even making house chores, right? If someone tells me to do something, I instantly dislike doing that something. But if it comes out of me, then I do it at my own rhythm, in my own way. It feels much better. And that's what I started doing with music. I'm just going to make it on my own pace. Just express how I want it to express, even if it takes, I don't know, 2 years to finish the album. It's going to be something that I'm going to be proud of and that I'm going to, you know, want to put out.
Yeah.
And everything that I'm doing, both in music and IRL, is kind of like dictated by that. If I can make it so that it's enjoyable, then I'm going to try to make it so that it's enjoyable.
I feel like if you just follow trends or whatever, then it doesn't really feel like your style anymore. You're just going based off of what other people are doing just because it's popular. So I feel like if you don't follow trends and do your own thing, then that's what really makes you, well, you.
Yes. Yes, definitely. If you're just riding a wave, then what distinguishes you from the other people that are in there, you know? Maybe the way that you conduct yourself, how you market yourself, whatever. But if you don't have a chance of doing that, then you're just another person making the same as other people are making. And hell, maybe you do it even worse than other people, or even better, or whatever, right? But it's still the same shit. When Tropical House became a thing back, well, some years ago. God, how many years ago did Tropical House become an actual thing?
I've never heard of Tropical House ever.
You're not missing anything, trust me. You know, Kygo, this guy, Kygo, KYGO, those kind of radio songs. It just came in and flew down afterwards. Shit genre, in my opinion. Leaving my personal preferences aside. Once it kind of felt like it had died out, I haven't heard any Tropical House song in probably 3 or 4 years, which is good because I don't like it. But at the same time, it's like, it just shows you that music goes in waves. And sometimes you just don't have to ride the wave. You just have to jump on the water and go down and down and down till you find yourself, and then you go back up and you create maybe your own wave. Like, I don't know, like Sewerslvt did, or whatever artist, Jedwill with Hyperpop or whatever, you know. If you just do your own thing, not only you're going to be more, like, more satisfied with yourself, or you're going to sound like whatever the hell you are, and that's really cool. If people can feel that you're unique, then you are unique. I feel like I'm unique, but it's not shown, then I'm not really that unique. But maybe it's that is just me, like, putting an extra pressure on myself sometimes. Is weird. Making music is super cool, but never take it seriously.
Yeah, definitely. People just care about numbers sometimes. Even I fall into some traps where I just start, like, worrying about numbers and shit, but it doesn't feel nice, but I at least get over it at some point. But I don't really want to get too in-depth into that.
Yeah, dude, when the France J thing happened, and I was, like, getting those crazy numbers, I was, like, in heaven. Then people started, like, not going onto my SoundCloud that much, and views started to go down. And I was, like, shit, what the fuck did I do? And then I just realized, oh, yeah, I just had an explosive burst towards small fame. This is normal, you know? It just goes to show how numbers can just affect you that much. So much that you can just get used to them. When I had 200, 300 subscribers, I was, like, celebrating like crazy. Now I have almost 3,000. It's sad because I don't feel the same. Oh, yeah, I have these followers now. And even inside of my heart, I do feel thankful for every single one of them. It's just not the same as when I had 300 and it came from zero, you know?
Yeah.
Now it's just, I have more. And I get used to seeing those numbers, right? And same with the plays. I just, okay, 1,000 daily plays, nice. But like back then, when the Sewerslvt thing happened, when she retweeted my remix, I was getting 200 instead of 5, and I was like going crazy over it. So it just goes to show you that the more you get used to something, the more you think it has less value, right? I don't know. If I started getting like 5K a day again, I would be like super surprised and definitely happy. But when the time comes, those plays would go down again. And I probably have to remind myself again that, yeah, this is normal now. So numbers, honestly, if you can just not focus on them, which is, well, kind of inevitable at some point, try not to focus on them because, you know, if people like your stuff, then good. If people don't like your stuff, well, that's good too. The thing is, if you aim to get bigger and better, then you're going to put much more pressure on yourself than if you just said, okay, I'm going to make music.
Yeah.
See, I'm just rambling again.
Yeah, we're now at an hour and 34 minutes. That's how long we've been going for. Time flies by really fast.
Yeah.
But, yeah, I know, it's weird.
Session with such a cool host. He can just help it.
I feel like I'm humble, but I don't really think of myself like that. But I appreciate your words either way.
I can definitely guarantee you, you're like, I don't know. If I ever have another interview, it's not going to be as cool as being interviewed by you.
Dude, don't say that. Thanks.
You, I think just be natural, you know, and start spewing stuff.
Even if
it's just complete bullshit.
The interviews are generally like very robotic and just very like uninterested. It doesn't have like substance in it.
Just having a conversation with someone.
Yeah, which is what I planned this podcast to be ever since like I did the episode with Buckcore. It just like sort of took off from there.
Ooh, can I ask you a question?
Yeah, sure.
Who would you definitely want in here? Like, sure, your biggest shot.
Who I want on the podcast?
Yeah, shoot your biggest shot. Like, the biggest person you want to get.
Biggest person? Oh, God. I was, like, as outlandish as this sound, I wanted to get Sewer on the podcast, but that's not happening. Definitely not. I don't know, dude. I really don't know. I feel like I'm just able to just contact anyone, and it's either yes or no, but I can't really think of anyone that I can't contact, really. But I can't contact because I'm very hesitant to reach out to anyone at all.
It did happen to me before, like with IRL stuff. But if I can guarantee, if you don't shoot your shot, you don't know where you're going to land.
Yeah.
Just ask people and probably they'll say yes because you're a cool person. And
yeah.
In a podcast is a cool thing.
I wouldn't consider Metaroom a big person, but I definitely would like to get him on the podcast soon. I might ask him next. I really want to ask him. Just a lot of people have been asking me recently, hey, are you going to ask Freddy to be on the podcast? And I'm just like, I don't know, dude. I listen to Metaroom a lot, talk just a tiny bit. We're cool. But
something that I have learned while meeting bigger people than me, if you can even consider people bigger, that they're just people. You know, they just have bigger numbers, but they act the same as we do.
Yeah, that's what I've been told.
So, like, just ask Freddy if you need help and I can convince him. But
I know Buck said he was going to help me out with that, but nothing so far.
Imagine being Metaroom and just waking up to 25 messages on your inbox saying, oh, yeah, go to this guy's podcast.
Yeah, I mean, I don't care if it's in the month, 2 months or whatever. I can literally do it whenever except for when I'm in school. By the end of August, I'm going to be back in school, so I'm less time, I guess.
I hate school, dude.
Yeah.
I only have to go to one subject because the teacher that failed me with a 4.8 out of 10. So I have to do one whole subject again.
Just one the entire semester? Yeah,
just one the entire semester. It's horrible.
All right. It's been an hour and 40 minutes. Do you have anything else to say?
I have nothing. The only thing that I have is my eyes half closed because I'm about to fall asleep. Not going to lie.
Well, okay. So we're going to wrap it up and I'll tell you that little story about Sewer.
Oh, yeah.
All right. So, Telemist, thank you very much for even accepting this offer. If this was me back in January, then I would have been actually shaking. But I've talked to more artists to just realize that, hey, this artist likes me. This is really cool. I'm going to talk to them for a bit.
So, we all like everybody.
Yeah.
Don't be afraid of asking anyone.
So, yeah, thank you very much for joining in. I really do appreciate that.
Thank you for having me. This has been super, super cool experience. 10 out of 10 would do again.
All right. So thank you all. Thank you all for listening. And I don't know what the next guest is going to be. Take care, I guess. See you all.